Today we are going to speak about mean variance portfolio optimization as promised earlier. Here the investments that we make are not on projects, but it is made on assets which are sold in the financial market, for example stocks. So the portfolio is essentially a basket of securities or stocks or some financial instruments. An asset, to be more frank, an asset is a object which is regularly sold and bought in a financial market. So we are talking about financial assets. So what is a portfolio? Portfolio can be viewed in two ways. One way is you can line up the assets which are going to be funded by you. Rather, basically you can think like this, that you are going to go to the stock market and buy shares of stocks of certain different companies. So those particular stocks can represent your portfolio. So another more convenient way of writing the portfolio is the following, that if you have X0 amount of initial investment, now the idea is that how will I distribute this investment so that I buy, say, n different stocks of different companies, n different companies. So what I do, I distribute these things. So one fraction of the weight of the total money is for, say, the company one, the second, another fraction is for company two, another fraction is for company 3, where W1, W2, W3 are the weights which are telling what proportion you are going to invest. So basically, so for the nth company it's WN, the weights. Of course, finally if you add this total investment on various different stocks, they should add up to X0, and that would imply, of course, that the weights, the proportion, should sum up to 1. So a portfolio can also be viewed as a collection of these weights. So what is the way you distribute your initial wealth among various investment or various instruments, so that you buy these instruments, various instruments, at time, say, t equal to 0, at time t equal to 1 you sell them. We are going to talk about investment in a single period. So you buy at time 0 and sell at time 1, which could be 1 month, 1 year, whatever. But of course you can talk about multi-stage investments. So you buy now, sell at time 1, again buy at time what, sell at time 2, a thing which will very soon come. But as far as portfolio optimization is there, we are not going to really bother about multi-stage things. We are just going to, because multi-stage things would complicate matters, so we are just going to look at the things in single window framework. That is, at t equal to 0 I buy by investing X naught, and at t equal to 1 I sell those shares and I get a return. I receive X1, means I make money X1. So the return on the investment, or total return, or sometimes called the return on the investment, which is written as R, is the ratio of how much I have received and how much I have invested. So if this is R is greater than or equal to 1, then I have received more than I have invested, and hence I made a profit. And if it is less than or equal to 1, of course I have received less than what I have invested, so I have made a loss. So this rate of return captures both sides of the upside and the downside of a securities market. So what we would be really interested in is called the relative rate of return. Let us note that this X naught, the initial investment, is known to me, but how much I will earn in period 1 at time 1 is not known to me. It can vary depending on the nature of the market at that time, nature of what are the prices at that time. So this X1 is actually a random variable. Thus making R, the total return, also a random variable, which for short I am writing as RV. So the relative rate of return, which says that okay, I have invested X naught and got X1, so how much is the difference between X1 and X0? And the ratio of that with X0, so X1 minus X0 divided by X0 is what is called the relative rate of return. So this is what is my gain or loss, and the rate measures that to what extent, how much is the loss or gain with respect to the initial investment. So that is, that means that is the rate of return. So change in the investment by the original investment, like essentially like the concept of the derivative, right? So you can very well write down, you can easily see that capital R is related to the small r in this fashion. But note that R is itself also a random variable. So now let us, here we are talking about a return only on, this is, I am talking about the total return. So let us see how we can view the total return in terms of the relative individual returns, because if you are investing in each of these stocks 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, dot, dot, n, then each of them will have some return, and how can I view the total return as a sum of all the individual returns, and then from there we would like to compute their means and variances and all those things, which would be important to set up what is called the Markowitz mean variance portfolio model. So Markowitz is a researcher, an economist, who got a Nobel Prize in 1990 for this work. It's important to remember that why we are making this investment. The idea of making this investment is to make money. So you invest, but since you are exposed to risk, you do not know whether you would gain or whether you would lose. So what you do, that you expect a certain amount of return from the market, and you want to have that amount of money, at least that amount of money, and you want to minimize your exposure to risk in order to get that money. So Markowitz viewed variance of a portfolio as the risk associated with the portfolio. Of course, now there are many other ways of looking at risk, through way of value at risk and CVAR and all those things. So the convex value at risk. So we will not get into general study of risk functions, because that would take us to something called infinite dimensional convex analysis. We'll not do that, but we will just try to now see how to write the return of the portfolio in terms of the return of these individual assets. So as we were discussing, let for each of the individual assets, my return is written as RI. So what is, so if I look at XOI as the amount of money I have invested in the asset I, then this is nothing but this one, where WI is a proportion of money invested in the asset I. Of course, I do not have to remind you, though I am writing it down, that this is 1. So now let RI denote the total return on asset I. If this is so, then I know that RI X0I is the amount of money I generate by trading in the asset I. So it is the money generated by trading in the asset I, basically selling it. Of course, there is the issue of short selling, which I am not coming, but I will tell you at the end what, there are some other facts here also. So the money generated by trading at asset I totally is RI WI X naught. Okay. So total money generated by trading in the whole portfolio is just nothing but the summing over all the assets. So the rate of return R in the total portfolio, or the total return on the whole portfolio, which is R as we have written, is summation I is equal to 1 to n RI WI XI, sorry, this whole thing divided by X naught, the total money that I have put in. Okay. Sorry, this is X naught. So now you can divide this whole thing by X naught. So return is now summation I is equal to 1 to n WI RI. So knowing that summation WI equal to 1, so since summation WI is equal to 1, you can immediately calculate that the relative return is nothing but summation omega I RI, the return on the relative return on the individual assets. So once we have this formula of relative return in our hands, that the total return is nothing but the weighted sum of the individual assets, we can now proceed to compute the expectation and the variance of this particular quantity R. So this random variable, of course, we assume that it follows certain distribution, etc., etc., which we may not bother at this stage, that what exactly the distribution is. We will not bother at all about it at this moment, but we will assume that it follows certain distribution which has a finite expectation variance, because without that we can't work, because we have. So the idea is to minimize variance subject to the fact that I'll have a certain level of expected return, and then the certain basic condition like summation omega I equal to 1 should be there. So I have to find that optimal WI. So I have to find the optimal WI here. So WIs are my decision variables of the optimization problem that we are going to set up. So we start now talking about computing the expected value and the mean and variance of the portfolio. Of course, I assume that you know what is mean variance, you know what is covariance, so we are not going to be bothered about that. So my relative rate of return R is omega 1 R1, sorry, W2 R1 W2 R2 plus Wn Rn. So by the standard formula for expectation, which we call R bar, expectation of the return is expectation of R1 plus very basic fact about expectation. I am just writing it in too much detail, which I think I should not really write. So if I call them R1 bar, R2 bar, R3 bar like that, then R bar is nothing but the weighted sum of the means. So mean of the portfolio is weighted sum of the means. Now we will compute. So this is R bar is something which you will fix, that I need this amount of expected return. So I need, say, if I invest 1000 rupees, I expect 1200 rupees at least as expected return. So that's the whole thing. So now we will compute. So it is a mean of the rate of return, relative rate of return. Rate of return or relative rate of return is the same. Actually, the total return that we wrote, that is essentially the relative rate of return. But okay, we are not bothering. We have just defined this small r to be the rate of return. Now, we are going to compute the variance of R. We have to be very, very clear that here we have n random variables, because the individual returns are also random variables, and each of these random variables, they may not be independent, but they may be, you know, correlated. So you have to take into account that correlation. So this by definition is expectation of R minus R bar whole square, and this is nothing but expectation of, if I write down, summation I equal to 1 to n omega I R I minus summation I equal to 1 to n omega I R I bar. And that can be written as expectation summation I is equal to 1 to n omega I R I minus R I bar whole square. And this can be further decomposed as follows: expectation summation I is equal to 1 to n omega I R I minus R bar, sorry, R I minus R I bar into summation I is equal to 1 to n. So you are decomposing the square. It's exactly the way the squares would be taken. Just remember the formula a plus b plus c whole square, that's all. R, sorry, omega j, j is 1 to n, r j minus r j bar, and that's the thing. So from here I pick up and write the variance. So variance of R can now be written as I can, because when I do the clubbing, I can just take the sum in one. So basically, if you do the multiplication, you'll finally have just one set of sum. So that can be written as expectation of summation I j equal to 1 to n, because they are the same indices. So it's omega I omega, sorry, w I w j r I minus r bar r j minus r bar. And if you take the expectation, it tells you it's summation I equal to 1 to n omega I omega j expectation r I minus r bar r j minus r bar. And this is nothing but the covariance between the rate of return for the ith asset and rate of return for the jth asset. So this is nothing but I equal to ij, sorry, this is ij, ij equal to 1 to n omega I omega j, and this is nothing but the covariance of ri rj, and that is I equal to 1 to n omega I omega, sorry, wi wj. Don't forget, I would like to excuse you for calling the w's omega, but that has been my habit, so you can call it either omega or w as you please. So we'll have a simpler symbol for the covariance, which I write as sigma ij. And if you look at this, this is nothing but a bilinear product, it's an inner product, and this can be written as w sigma w, where sigma is a variance covariance matrix. So sigma is a variance covariance matrix. And this is given in the following: sigma one one square, which is nothing but sigma one square, which we are not writing, sigma one, sigma one two, sigma one n, sigma n one, sigma two n, sigma n square. So along the diagonal of this n cross n matrix, you have all the variances, and then these are the covariances. Of course, this sigma is a symmetric matrix, is a real symmetric matrix. I should write the word real, but okay, you can understand all the entries are real numbers. So it is a real symmetric matrix, and then you need to understand that variance of any random variable is always non-negative. So whatever be your chosen omega, or sorry w, this is always greater than or equal to 0. This would imply that the variance covariance matrix is a positive semi-definite matrix. Okay. Now we are going to talk about the importance of the notion of diversification of a portfolio, that it tells you that you do not put all your eggs in one basket, in the sense that don't invest in less stocks. If you invest in less stocks, less number of instruments, then you actually increase your variance. But when you invest in more stocks, your variance can become lesser and lesser. So let us discuss that part about diversification of a portfolio, and then we'll try to set up the Markowitz mean variance model. So now we are going to talk about something called diversification of the portfolio. So when we are talking about the diversification of the portfolio, we are meaning that you should increase your number of assets. So suppose now I have a set of assets, N assets, which are say uncorrelated for the time being, then your expected rate of return R bar is, suppose I invest equally in all assets, so for each assets I invest 1 by N, so it will be 1 by N summation R I bar. So that would be your expected return, and your variance, because you have uncorrelated asset now, variance of R is nothing but 1 by N square, so summation I is equal to 1 to N sigma I square. Now if sigma is suppose constant, they are all of them have constant sigma, if they are standard deviation, and this will give me N sigma square by N square, which will give me sigma square by N, and that goes to 0 as N tends to infinity. This is shown for the uncorrelated assets, but if you have correlated assets also, you can show the same thing, so it doesn't matter much. So suppose you have assets that, so each asset I has each asset I has mean say M or fixed R bar, mean each asset I has mean M, so sorry, R I bar is M, and then basically if R I bar is M, for this particular case it will become N M, so this will become fixed N M by N, right? So and has variance sigma square, each asset I, that is sigma I square is sigma square. Further, let these be correlated, and the covariance between Ri and Rj, which is sigma ij, is given as say 0.3 times sigma square. So this is covariance of any pair ij is also fixed, say some percentage of some fraction of sigma square. So once you know that, if you calculate the variance, what will happen? So you will see a slight difference when you have uncorrelated assets and when you have correlated assets. So variance of R, so if I write directly in terms of the weights, so it will become one by N summation I is equal to 1 to N Ri minus Ri bar whole square. So I am taking the weights to be equal, right? An expected value 1 by N would now, sorry, this should be 1 by N whole square, not. So I will have to take this 1 by N out. So it will become 1 by N square here. Expectation of the same thing, summation Ri minus Ri bar I equal to 1 to N, this one into I equal to 1 to, sorry, J equal to 1 to N R J minus R J bar. So once we have done that, so here we know that this is 1 by N square summation sigma ij, ij equal to 1 to N. So this can be divided into two parts, 1 by N square summation I equal to j sigma ij plus summation I not equal to j sigma ij. So in that variance covariance matrix, it's n cross n matrix, so the n square elements, n elements in the diagonal are here the sigma j, the variances. So that will give me 1 by n square n sigma square plus, now the remaining elements that are left in the matrix is n square minus n, take off the variances. So you have n square minus n correlated things, sigma ij's with I not equal to j, and then you write that as 0.3 times n square minus n sigma square. So here you have 0.3 n sigma square plus n sigma square. So whatever here it is, so it will become 1.3 sigma square as you add this, sorry minus, sorry 0.7 sigma square by n plus 0.3 sigma square. So here you see that as n tends to infinity, this part goes to 0, but this part doesn't go to 0. So at n tends to infinity, this will go to 0. So however, whatever amount of you extend, meaning if you keep on increasing the number of assets that you invest, your risk would never go down below 0.3 sigma square. So you cannot take your risk below 0.3 sigma square. It will be some 0.3 sigma square plus some quantity. So 0.3 sigma square is the minimum risk that you are exposed to once you are correlated, correlated stuff. So this is the one wants to be exposed to just this risk, not any additional risk. So that's the issue. So we stop here today, short of telling you about the Markovitz mean variance model, which will be in the part 2 of the lectures. This lecture will have 3 lectures. So part 2 of the lecture, we are going to talk about the optimization aspects. So what we are going to do essentially is we want to minimize this half is just for taking the gradient. So find the weight distribution, weight vector W, where we minimize the variance subject to the expected return R to be some fixed rho, summation Wi is equal to 1. Of course, you can write this as summation Wi Ri bar, where Ri bars are now fixed, one, because once you know the mean values, they are known. So there is a stochastic element into it. There's a issue because you're handling random variables, but ultimately when you take a mean and variance, you really have converted into some problem which is the standard problem where you do not have the uncertainty. Of course, the uncertainty is inbuilt itself here in the expectation. It's very built in here in the variance because it depends on some distribution. Once you change the distribution, maybe the whole structure of this, or this sigma will change, this Ri bar will change. But once you know the distribution, you have actually got a problem which is completely deterministic. So this is the portfolio optimization problem, Markovitz model. You might ask that what about this? Omega, summation omega I greater than equal to 0, why didn't you put it? That looks to be very natural. So here we bring in the idea of short selling, and this is exactly with what this model and the notion of short selling is exactly with what we will start our discussion in the next lecture. Thank you very much.